This is lecture 12, part 3. So in last part, we have discussed what is equilibrium point of a dynamical system. So in this part, we will be discussing that linearization of nonlinear systems. So let a nonlinear system be given as, so let a nonlinear system be given as, suppose a nonlinear system is described by its state space equation, that is x dot equal to fx u, x is that state vector and u is that input, and y, that output equation, is that hx. And here we assume that this function f and this h, they are smooth nonlinearity. That means they are differentiable. So let us assume the system has one operating point, and that operating point may be at equilibrium point or at any arbitrary point. So let the operating point is, we assume that operating point is x0, y0, corresponding to the input u0. So that means if we apply that input u0, then corresponding to that state x0 and output is y0. So we assume that this is that operating point. And we will be linearizing that dynamical system at that operating point. So first, we would like to expand the nonlinear state equation in Taylor series. So expanding the nonlinear state equations, that means that system equation as well as that output equation, into Taylor series. I think you all know that Taylor series, you have studied it in basic calculus. So if we expand it with respect to that operating point, what we get? So the first, that system equation x dot equal to that f x0 u0. So with respect to this operating point, we are expanding it. So the first term, this function of x0 u0, then you take the partial derivative of that function x u with respect to x, and you calculate at that operating point, that is at x0 u0, and this is that perturbation. That means if you take a small perturbation with respect to that x0, then the other term is that del f x u del u, that is x0 u0, and here the small perturbation with respect to that u0 point, plus you have all higher order terms. So we are only taking the first order terms, and what would be that output equation? That output equation is y equal to hx0 plus, as we have assumed that it is not function of u, only it is function of x, so that's why del x, you find it at x equal to x0, and this is that small perturbation plus higher order terms. So this is the Taylor series expansion of that state equations, that is system equation and the output equation. So now we assume that let the perturbation that we have given with respect to that operating point, the perturbation that is delta x equal to x minus x0, and the delta u that is u minus u0, and delta y that is y minus y0. So this is that perturbation with respect to that operating point. And you can note that since if you look at that state equation here, if you look at that state equation, so that means as x0 and u0 is one operating point, so if you put it here x0 and u0, it also satisfies this equation because x0 dot equal to function of x0 and u0. So here we can write that since x0 dot, because the differential equation also be satisfied for that operating point x0 u0, we have delta x dot, because here you can see here, so for this particular perturbation, so if you take derivative, so you have that delta x dot equal to x dot minus x0 dot. So now you can see here that x0 dot is equal to that x dot minus, so here f x0 u0. So that means delta x dot equal to x dot minus f x0 u0. Now if you look at here, so if you bring this term to left, so that is x dot minus f x0 u0. So x dot minus f0 x u0, f x0 u0 is equal to delta x dot. So I write it here delta x dot. So delta x dot equal to, if you just ignore all the higher order terms, so what we have this term and that term, so that is delta x dot equal to that delta f del f by del x, and calculate this derivative, partial derivative at that operating point, and you have already assumed that x minus x0 equal to delta x. So here you can see x minus x0 equal to delta x. So just I have replaced it here. Then delta f del f by del u, you find it at x0 u0 del u. So we have neglecting the higher order terms. So this is actually one approximation, I would say. So that's why in place of equal to, I can put that it is nearly equal to. And here, what would be the output equation? So output equation, similarly here, if you take that yx0 to the left, so y minus hx0, here you can see as y0 equal to hx0, so y minus hx0 equal to delta y. So you have another equation, that is delta y equal to that del h by del x calculated at x0, that operating point, into del x. So here you can see, that means whenever a nonlinear system is described as x dot equal to function of x and u, and output equation is y equal to hx, then just by expanding those state equations in Taylor series, and defining that perturbation as taking a very small perturbation with respect to that operating point, you can have the delta x, delta u, and delta y, and finally you have one linearized model of that nonlinear system, that is delta x dot equal to del f by del x, calculated at that operating point x0, y0, delta x, and this term and this term. So this is the linearized model. And here, if you, so here we have just considered that x is a single vector. So if you have, if you have a state vectors like say here xi dot, so many state variables are there, function of x1, x2, say suppose you have n number of state variables and m number of inputs, so then the linearized system, linearized model is ddt of, so del x1, that is that perturbation of this first state, this is for the second state, this is that perturbation with respect to that operating point. So any operating point you can take, but normally we choose that operating point as that equilibrium point. And here, as you have, so here you can see that you have n number of states, x1, x2, and up to xn. So you have here I, so you have n number of functions, that is f1, f2, f3, like that. So then you have a matrix, that is del f1 by del x1, del f1 by del x2, like that, del f1 by del xn. Similarly, you have del f2 by del x1, del f2 by del x2, and del f2 by del xn. Similarly, you have that del fn by del x1, del fn by del x2, del fn by del xn. So you have one n cross n matrix where each element is that partial derivative, and calculate this matrix at that operating point. And you have del f, del x1, del x2, del xn. Similarly, as you have n number of, m number of inputs, so you have that B matrix, that is del f1 by del u1, del f1 by del u2, del f1 by del um, so del f1 by del u2, so here you have that del f by here f2, f2 by del, sorry, so this is u1, this is u2, so del f2 by del um. Similarly, you have del fn by del u1, del fn by del u2, and del fn by del um. So this is actually your linearized model's input matrix, and that input vector, that is del u1, del u2 to del um. So this is that input matrix you have. And similarly, so if you take that, okay, you have say single output, so you can write that say del y, but you have n number of vectors, that is del h by del x1, del h by del x2, So here del h by del x n, n number of state variables, and here you have del x1, del x2 to del xm. So this is actually that linearized model. And so let me explain it once more. So that means whenever you have nonlinear systems described as x dot equal to function of xu and y equal to hx, and those are smooth nonlinearity. So smooth nonlinearity, that means they are differentiable, but if they are not smooth, so you cannot apply this particular method. So in that case, you need to follow other methods for linearization. So then first, by expanding that nonlinear state equations in Taylor series, you can have it. And then you can calculate those values at some operating point. Normally, when you linearize that nonlinear system, we do it at equilibrium point. And already in last part, in previous part, we have discussed what is that equilibrium point and how to find that equilibrium points. So then, neglecting that higher order terms, we can find one linearized model. And here you can see that this is that system matrix. This is that system matrix of the linearized system. This is that input matrix, and this is that output matrix. So this is system matrix, and this is input matrix, and that is output matrix. We assume that feed forward matrix equal to zero. So here this matrix has a special name called that Jacobian matrix. So this input matrix, the system matrix, is known as Jacobian matrix. So sometimes this method is also called that Jacobi method. So that means here, whenever a nonlinear system is given with smooth nonlinearity, so you can expand those state equation and output equation in Taylor series, and you can have that Jacobian matrix, that is that system matrix, input matrix, and output matrix. So this is that linearization of our nonlinear systems with smooth nonlinearity. So we will just understand this technique via one example, and it is actually one physical system, and those who will be performing control and instrumentation lab, they will be performing this experiment in the lab. So first we'll just derive the mathematical model of this setup, and this is actually one engineer systems, physical system. So first we'll just derive the mathematical model of that physical system, and then we'll linearize it, because you will see that it is nonlinear systems and it has smooth nonlinearity. So we can follow this method that you have discussed now. So the first example, what we are just trying to study, going to study now. So that is that modeling of attractive type magnetic levitation system. Magnetic levitation system. So this is actually the setup, the schematic diagram. So here you have that solenoid. This is that solenoid, and you have applied some voltage source here. Then this is that inductance, and this is that resistance. So now whenever some current will flow through this circuit, some current I, then there will be some attractive force will be generated by that magnet, and this is a ball, steel ball with mass m, and suppose this distance is y. Suppose this distance is y, so due to that weight of that ball, it's a steel ball, so the weight, because of that weight mass, there is one force, that is mg, g is that gravitational constant, and one force will be generated by this solenoid, this magnet, so that is I square by y square. So y is that distance from this magnet to this ball. So now this force will be balanced by this mg, and whenever they are in equilibrium, so this ball will be levitated, this ball will be levitated in the air. So this is actually that setup, and I hope you all know it, so that you know, magnetic levitated disc, and it has a lot of applications as well. First we'd like to derive that mathematical model of this particular system. So this is a physical system, and first we write what is that force equation. So that is m d2y by dt2. So that means the force, that is mg minus that magnetic levitated force I square by y square. And that KVL for this particular circuit, that KVL, that is ET equal to R IT. So here all are T actually. So R IT plus L DIT by DT. So we have two equations. One is that force equation. So this is that force equation, and this is that KVL. We have applied that circuit, and then in first step we'll be trying to represent this particular system in state space model. So then for doing that one, let us define the state. Let x1, this is one state. So from here you can understand that how many state variables are needed to describe it. First of all, you can see that there are two differential equations. So this is one differential equation, this is another differential equation. So these two linear differential equations, they are linearly independent. And here you can see the order is 1, and here you can see the order is 2. So the number of state variables required to represent that system is the sum of that order. So that means 1 plus 2, that is 3. So three states are needed to represent that system in state space form. So let us first define that x1t equal to yt, that is that distance, and then x2t, that is the derivative of that first state, so that is nothing but that y dot, and x3t, that is the current what is flowing through that circuit. So we defined these three state variables, and then we can see from here the first equation. You can see the d2y by dt2. So d2y by dt2 means here you can see that x2 dot. So in place of here, I put that x2 dot because y dot equal to this one. So y double dot equal to x2 dot. Equal to, if you divide by m, so you will get that g minus I square, I is that x3, so that is x3 square, and y is that x1. So you can see from just looking at this particular of state equation that it is a hugely nonlinear system. And what is that x1 dot? The x1 dot equal to x2, already you have defined here. And what is x3 dot? X3 dot here, that is from this equation, if you divide by L, so then you can find that x3 dot equal to if you take this one to left, this term to left and divided by L, so that is R by L x3 plus 1 by L et. So this is actually that system equation, and the output equation is x1t equal to yt. So now let us define that, say as this is x2 dot, so this function is f2 function, and here you can see that this is f1 function and this is f3 function. So now we'll be linearizing this particular system. So these all are the nonlinear state equations. So I hope it is clear that why it is nonlinear. You can see here that this is x3 square divided by x1 square. So this term actually makes this system nonlinear. Then before applying that linearization technique, we'll be finding what is that equilibrium point, because we'll be linearizing that system at equilibrium point. So equilibrium point. So as you know that for finding equilibrium point, you need to make that x1 dot equal to 0, x2 dot equal to 0, and x3 dot equal to 0. So if we put that x1 dot equal to 0, so that is x2 equal to 0 here. So x1 dot equal to 0, it implies that x2, so this is equal to 0. This one is indicated for that equilibrium point, x2 0. Now for x3 equal to 0, so x2 dot equal to 0, if you just put x2 dot equal to 0, so the first equation you can see here, so then that would be g minus x3 square divided by x1 0 square equal to 0. And for x3 dot equal to 0, we get minus RL x3 0 plus 1 by L E 0, because that is that equilibrium point. So if we assume that, let x1 0 equal to y is b the equilibrium distance. So that means here, if you look at this particular diagram, so if you would like to levitate this ball, say suppose at 5 centimeter distance, so this distance is, say suppose, 5 centimeter. So that means if we assume that this distance is 5 centimeter, that means our objective is to levitate that ball at 5 centimeter distance. So that means we assume that this x0 equal to y, that means x0 x10 is equal to 5 centimeter, is the equilibrium distance. So then from this particular equation, you can see that x30, so here you can see x30 x10 square into g, and here I think we have missed one term. That means whenever we are dividing it by m, so here we would have 1 by m. So that means 1 by m is here. So then we have that m square root. Just from this equation we get. So that means the equilibrium point, whenever you fix that x10 equal to that y, that means suppose it is 5 cm, then we can find what is that x30, and x1.0 gives that x20 equal to 0. So now we'll be just applying, and from here also you can find what is that voltage you need to get that distance. So that means from this particular equation, you get that 1 by L E0 equal to R L X30. So E0 equal to R X30. So that means this is actually that voltage you need to levitate that ball at 5 cm. Suppose we take that distance as 5 cm, this y. So this is that equilibrium point, and at that equilibrium point you have seen that derivative of all the states equal to 0. So now our next target is to linearize that system. So here already we have defined what is f1, what is f2, and what is f3. So now if you look at that linearized model, so you need to find what is del f1 by del x1, del f2 by del f1 by del x2, and del f1 by del xn. And here you have three state variables, x1, x2, and x3. So we need to find what is del f1 by del x1. So if you look at here, f1 is x2. So that means del f1 by del x1 equal to 0. Then del f1 by del x2 equal to 1, and del f1 by del x3 equal to 0, and del f1 by del e, that means the e is that input, that is equal to 0. So again we find what is del f2 by del x1. So let us see what is f2. So f2 is this one. So then you can see that here you have x3 square. Here you have x3 square by x1 square. So that means if you take the derivative of this one, so you get that 2 by m x3 square divided by x1 cube. And you need to find it at the equilibrium point, and that equilibrium point is x10, x30. So if you replace it here, you get that 2 by m, and you can see here it would be x30 square divided by x10 cube. So x30 square, here you can see, so that is 2 x10 square gm by m x10 cube. So then you will get that 2g x10. So that means we have derived what is del f2 by del x1 at the equilibrium point. So now what is del f2 by del x2? So del f2 by del x2, here you can see del f2 by del x2, here it is independent of x2, so that's why it would be equal to 0. And del f2 by del x3, so then that would be 2m x3 divided by x1 square, and you find it at x3 0, x1 0, so you will get 2 by m, and here x3 0, so x3 0 divided by x1 0 square, and we just replace it here, so that means minus 2 by m, that is mg x1 0 square divided by x1 square. So we get that del f2 by del x3 and calculated at that equilibrium point. So then what is del f3 by del x1? So if you look at that del f3, this one, so this is independent of x1 and x2. So then we can directly write that del f3 by del x1 equal to 0. Then del f3 by del x2 equal to 0. And del f3 divided by del x3 equal to minus r by l. And here that another term is there, that is del f3 by del e, that is equal to 1 by l. So we get all the partial derivatives. Now we can write what is that linearized system. So the linearized system is ddt of, we have three state variables, that is del x1, del x2, del x3. So three state variables. Then the first one is del f1 by del f1 by here, del x1, del f1 by del x2, and del f1 by del x3. So 0, 1, 0. So we get 0, 1, 0. Then let us see what is del f2 by del x2, this one, that is 0. Then del f2 by del x3 calculated at, del f2 by del x1. So del f2 by del x1 is 2g by x1, 0. So that is 2g by x1 0. Now del f2 by del x2, that is 0. Del f2 by del x1 3, that is minus 2 by m. So all those values are calculated at the equilibrium point. So we are linearizing that system at equilibrium point. Then del f3 by del x1 equal to 0, equal to 0, minus r by l. And here you can see that this is del f, del x1, del x2, del x3. And that input matrix is 0, 0, 1 by l, e, delta e. So this is that linearized state equation, system equation. So let us see what we have done here. So this is that modeling of attractive type magnetic levitation system. This is a physical system and it has one winding, and this is that solenoid. Whenever current is passed through this coil, then attractive force is generated, and this is one steel ball. This is a steel ball and it has some mass. Because of that mass, you have that mg, and that mg is balanced by this particular force. So we have this force equation and we have that KVL for that winding, and finally we get that nonlinear equation. We have defined three state variables, that is that distance and velocity and that current, and from there we get that nonlinear state equations, and then we have calculated that equilibrium points. And with respect to that equilibrium point, we have linearized that system. So this is one physical system, and let us take one more physical system. Say, suppose if we take a circuit, then how to get that model, and we'll be applying all the methods that we have learned. So let us take one more example. So suppose we have one circuit here. One inductor. So here you have one source, voltage source. Here you have the capacitor and one resistor. R2, L2. Suppose this voltage is EC. C is that capacitance, L1 is that inductance, and R1 is that resistance. And you have suppose applied that input voltage ET and current flowing here, that is I1, and current flowing here, this is I2. So now the problem is as follows. Say represent the circuit here, represent the circuit in state space, form. Also draw the signal flow graph and find transfer function from ES. ES is that Laplace transform of ET, ES to I2S. So this is that problem. So here, first we write the differential equation. Just we apply that KCL and KVL. So this is, I am not going to discuss those things in detail. So you can see that di1 by dt plus R1 I1 plus ECT, that first KVL I am writing for the first loop here. So this is that loop. In this loop, this is, I write that KVL. Then for other loop, you can write that di2 by dt plus r2 i2. So here for that loop, that is equal to ect. And if you write that KCL here at that particular node, that dc by dt, that is that current plus i2 current is equal to i1t. So these are the three differential equations you have. So then you can write these three differential equations in state space form, because these three are the linearly independent equations. And if you write it in state space form, what you get, that is di1 by dt and here di2 by dt. And here you have dec by dt. So one thing you can notice here, there are three state variables, and also just by looking at that circuit, you can also understand that how many state variables are needed. So basically the number of energy storing elements. So that is one inductor, this is another inductor, and this is one capacitor. So number of energy storing elements is equal to actually the number of state variables you need to completely describe that circuit. So in this case, as there are three energy storing elements, so we need three state variables. And here you can see the state variables we have defined, that I1, I2, and the voltage across that capacitor. So if we just write these three equations in matrix form, what we get, that is R1 by L1, 0, that is minus 1 by L1, 0, minus R2 by L2, and then 1 by L2, then 1 by C, minus 1 by C, and 0. So I am just writing those differential equation in matrix form, and we get this particular state space description. So this is that system equation. So then we need to write what is that output equation. So output equation, that is I2, because you can see here we need to find that what is that current I2. So here that I2 equal to, this is that second state variable, so that is I1, I2 and EC. So we have one circuit, and for that circuit we get one state space model. First we write that differential equation, and from there we get that state space model. So now we need to draw the signal flow graph. So signal flow graph, you can easily do it. So if you just look at this differential equation, these three differential equations, so from here you can directly draw that signal flow graph. I am just drawing it. So here, this is one node, 1/L1, and input is your ET, and this node is actually I1/dt. So I1 dot, here you can see that I1 dot, we are actually doing this one. And then you can see, if you take one integration here, if you put one integrator here, so that would be actually your I1, and then you need one feedback here, so that is -R1/L1. Here you can see, if you divide this one divided by L1, and if you take this one to right hand side, so then that would be I1 dot equal to -R1/L1 into I1. Another one is -1/L1 into EC. So here, if you just multiply this one with 1/C, then you will get, here you can see this one. So that is dEC/dt. So what is dEC/dt? So dEC/dt equal to 1/C. So that is dEC/dt equal to 1/C, then I1 minus I2. So here I have taken that IC into I1 by IC into I2. So now, if you multiply with this 1/C, then this point we get that 1/C into I1. Then here we need to take one branch that gives you that -1/C I2. So basically here you multiply by 1/C gain, and if you put one integrator here, you have that EC, and then again from the second equation you can have it here, from the second differential equation, if you divide by 1/L2, you get that dI2/dt. And here you just put another integrator, then you have that I2. So now you join this loop here, then dEC/dt equal to 1/C I1 -1/C I2. So that one is satisfied. And this is your output 1. And here you can see that. So here you can write that dI1/dt. So if I use the different color here, so that is dI1/dt equal to -R1/L1 I1 -1/L1 ECT plus ET. So if you look at here, so ET we get, then 1 -1/L ECT. -1/L ECT we did not get. So basically we need to close a loop here. Its gain is -1/L1. So that is L1. So we get that one, and this is -R1/L1 I1. So -R1/L1 we get it. So this one is done. And what happens in case of dI2/dt2? So here we can see that di2 by dt2. So in this case, so that is di2 by dt. If we take on the right hand side, that is r2 by l2 i2 plus 1 by l2 ect. So here we can see that di2 by d2, that is 1 by l2 ec, 1 by l2 ec, we get this term. So we need to get that term. So that means one feedback is needed with the gain minus r2 l2 from i2. So that means from i2, this is that i2, this is that i2. So we need one feedback here. So that is minus r2 by l2. So this is actually that signal flow graph. And here, from here, you need to find what is the transfer function. So apply that Mason's gain formula. So apply Mason's gain formula. So for applying Mason's gain formula, first we need to find what is that forward path. So here you have only one forward path. So only one forward path. So then if you see the gain, that is 1 by L1. So that means I'm writing here, that is I2S, that is that output by input ES. So the forward path, only one forward path is there, that is 1 by L1, then 1 by S, then 1 by C, then 1 by S, then 1 by L2, then 1 by S, and that one is equal to 1. So this is actually that forward path gain. So now we need to find that how many loops are there. So there are, so this is one loop, one, this is another loop, two, this is another loop, three, and this is another loop, four. So I'm just writing directly here. So one minus all the loop gains. So R1 by L1 S. So this loop, then this is that second loop, that is minus 1 by L1 CL square. Now, this is that third loop, minus 1 by L2 C S square. And this is that fourth loop, that is R2 by L2 S. So the next thing is, that would be plus, we need to find how many two non-touching loops are there. So two non-touching loops, here we can see that this is one loop and this is another one loop. So this is one non-touching loop. Now this one and that one, this is another combination, and this one and that one, this is another combination. So basically there are three pairs of non-touching loops, and I am just writing directly here. So I would suggest you to check, that is R1, R2, L1, L2, L square. So this is for one pair of loops, and another one is L1, L2, C, S cube, and then R2, L1, L2, C, S cube. So in this particular signal flow graph, there is no three non-touching loops. So basically we can stop it here. And then the transfer function that you would have, so you'll simplify that one and you get the transfer function, that is L1 L2 C S cube plus R1 L2 plus R2 L1 C S square plus L1 L2 R1 R2 C S plus R1 plus R2. So this is the transfer function. So what we have done in this particular problem, so one circuit is given, one simple circuit, and then we need to first find that state space. We write two KVLs, two KVLs and one KCL, and then we have written that differential equations in state space form, that is that system equation, and this is that output equation. Then from that state space equation we have drawn that signal flow graph, and from that signal flow graph we have applied that Mason's gain formula, and we get the transfer function from that applied voltage ES, the applied voltage ES to that output, this current I2. So we now will be discussing one mechanical system, and from there we'll be trying to establish the analogy with electrical circuit. So this is also very interesting and important example. So suppose, so this is that schematic diagram of one mechanical system. So suppose this is that spring, and here you have a mass, you have applied that force on that mass, and then the displacement is xt. And suppose one damper is here, that is the dashpot or damper, spring constant is k, and the damper viscous coefficient is b, and mass is m. So now for this particular spring mass damper system, so what would be the differential equation? That is Ft equal to m d2 xt by dt2 plus kx plus b dx by dt. So this is the differential equation, and let x1 equal to xt. So this is one state variable, and the other state variable is the derivative of this one. So that is dx1 by dt, that is equal to x2. So this is velocity and that is position. So we have taken two state variables, one is that velocity, another one is the position. So now if you just write this particular differential equation, if you rearrange the differential equation, then you have that dt dx2. So here you can see the dx2 by dt equal to minus b by m, we have taken those terms to the left and divided by m, that is x2 k by m x1, and here you have that m ft. So now we can see one thing, that is that here, so this x is that position and x2 is that velocity. So we can just write it like that, dv, so that velocity minus m, and here that x2 equal to that velocity. So velocity is defined by that. So here we can say that this is equal to v, and this one equal to that position, that is x. So that is kx by m plus 1 by m ft. So we have just written that differential equation in terms of that velocity and that position. So now if we just look at here, so this is that force acting on the spring. So let us define, let Fs is the force. So let Fs be the force acting on the spring. So then you can see here, so Fs equal to kx. So we have that relationship. So now if you take the derivative of that, so if you take dfs by dt, then you have that k dx by dt. So then this one equal to k into v, because dx by dt equal to velocity. So then we have that 1 by k, if we take k to the left. So 1 by k d fs by dt equal to that v. So we have that relationship here. That means if we consider that fs is the force acting on that spring, so then we have that relationship that velocity is equal to 1 by k into dfs by dt. So now if we just draw one series RLC circuit, so then what will you get? If you draw one series RLC circuit here, and that force, that is that voltage applied to that circuit is equal to that ET, and current flowing, that is IT, here you have that R, L and C, and that voltage is VC, voltage across that capacitor is VC. So then if you write that KVL, then you can write that ET equal to IT into R plus L DIT by DT plus 1 by C integration that IT DT. So then what you can see here, that voltage across that capacitor equal to that 1 by C integration, say 0 to T, that DT. So this implies that IT equal to C dVC by DT. So this relationship we have. So now if we represent this one in terms of, say, that is D, if we just rearrange this one, so DIT by DT equal to, if we take those terms to left, so that is we have R by L IT, and then 1 by L that is VCT. So here you can see that in place of this one is VC, so you have VCT plus 1 by L ET. So now you can see here, that means whenever you have a spring mass damper system like this, you have this equation, and if you just define that, okay, FS is that force acting on the spring, then we have this equation. So these two equations we are getting, this equation and that equation we are getting from that spring mass damper system. And here, if you have a series RLC circuit, then you have this equation, KVL, and this relationship. So now let us compare it. So if we start comparing, so then what we can see here, you can see that DIT by DT, and in this case dVT by DT. So that means that velocity and the current, velocity and current. So this is that current through that inductor, and here you can see that this is that velocity. So they are actually analogously equivalent. So what analogy we can draw here? So analogy. So if we draw the analogy, so that means force that is FT, which is that voltage source EMF. So this is actually that electrical equivalent. So that means here you can see that this is that force, and here you can see this is actually that EMF. And then that is 1 by L, and here you can see that this is 1 by N. So here mass and inductance, they are equivalent. That means that mass in mechanical system, that mass is equivalent to that inductance in electrical circuit. Similarly, you can see the damper that is B. So here if you look at the damper here, where is the damper? So here you can see that is B by N, and here you can see that is R by L. As we have seen that L is nothing but that M in mechanical circuit, so the damper is equivalent to the resistance in the electrical circuit. So here the damper and the resistor in the electrical circuit, they are analogously equivalent. Now the spring. So that spring K, you can look at here this equation IC equal to dVC by dt, and here you can see that dF by dt equal to that V. So that means here you can see that this C and 1 by K, they are actually that inverse relationship they have. So that spring and inverse of capacitance, that is 1 by C. So what we are trying to do, we are just trying to find that analogy with the electrical circuit with the mechanical. So now the force acting on spring that is Fs. So you can see here the force acting on spring, that is Fs. So Fs equal to that Ks, and here dFs by dt, and here you can see the dVc by dt. So that is actually the voltage across the capacitance. So that is equivalent to, that is that voltage across C, that is dVc. And the other one, you can see that velocity. So velocity here, if you look at this one, so that is current here, current through that inductor. And if you see the mechanical systems, that is dV. So that is that velocity and the current through the inductor, so they are same. That is velocity V, which is equivalent to that current through inductor. So it is very interesting to see. That means whenever you have a mechanical circuit, the mechanical system, so you can just draw analogy in electrical network. So that means if you have a spring mass damper system, you can see that analogically in spring mass damper system, so you can say that force acting on that mass is equivalent to the voltage applied to that circuit. Mass is equivalent to that inductance in electrical circuit. The damper, here it is actually resistor. Then spring, that is inverse of that capacitance. So you should remember those things, and also it is very easy to find out. That means what is that analogy. So let us see one more example, and so this example, it is actually that modeling of DC motor. So those who will be performing experiment in control lab, so they will be doing this particular experiment. And here this model is very simple. So our objective is to draw, find out that model. So suppose you have, this is that schematic diagram of a DC motor. This is that brush, and this is that DC motor. So it is very important because the DC motor is used in control systems as actuator. That is that motor torque. And here, suppose you have that load torque, TL. Now you have applied some voltage, that is VA. The current, what is flowing, that is IA, armature current. And this is that armature inductance. And you have some field coil. That means that field current is flowing here, that is that RF and LF. So because of that field, you know that force will be generated and that motor runs. So here, let us just define this nomenclature, that is that JM, that is motor inertia. Then BM, that is that viscous friction coefficient. Then TM, that is actually that motor torque, motor developed torque, motor torque. And TL is the load torque. Theta, this is actually that rotor displacement. And omega M, that is rotor angular velocity. So these all are the nomenclatures, and we are just trying to find out what would be that model, state space model, as well as that representation in block diagram. So first we write that KVL, that is that applied voltage equal to that armature current into that armature resistance, then LA dIA/dt plus that back EMF. So this one is called that back EMF. I hope you all know, in first year you have studied it. And then what is that back EMF? EB. So back EMF is actually directly proportional to that angular velocity of the shaft. And now the mechanical equation, that means the developed torque, that would be balanced by that JM. You can see it here, that is that motor inertia, JM. Now d omega m by dt, angular speed. Now b omega m plus that load torque. And this developed torque, as you know, this is actually directly proportional to that armature current. So here kt is that motor constant. And here we know that omega m equal to d theta by dt. So these are actually that four dynamical equations. And here you can see that how many state variables we need to define this particular dynamical system. So three state variables are needed. One is that this theta, another one is that omega, and other one is that current. So if we write those equations in matrix form, so we have that di by dt, then d omega by dt, then d theta by dt. So these are the three differential equations. And if we write it in matrix form, so we have armature inductance, then kt by j m, then minus b by j m, then 0 1 0. So I'm writing here just all these differential equations in matrix form. So then you have that current ia omega m theta. And here, interestingly, you can see that there are two inputs. So one input is actually that applied voltage. So here you can see that applied voltage, that is VA. So, and another one is that load torque here, load torque. So we actually treat that load torque as disturbance. So that's why I have separated it from that control input, VA. So this is actually that input matrix. So this is also input matrix, but it is associated with the disturbance signal. Then what is that output? Output is that speed. So speed is 0, 1, 0. And here you have that current, speed, and theta. So this is that state space model of a DC motor here. And then we will be just representing these equations in block diagram form. How? So if we take that Laplace transform here for this particular equation, if you take Laplace transform, so you get that VAS equal to IAS into RA. You can see here. Then LAS DIA. So that is LAS IAS. We assume that all initial conditions are zero. So this one, and from here you can find that IAS, if we take common here and if you divide it, so then IAS, we take that VAS minus KB omega MS here, and if we divide it by RA plus LAS, then we get this relationship. And the other one, if we take the Laplace transform of this particular differential equation, we get that KT IAS equal to JMS omega MS plus B omega MS plus TL. So now if you write it in this form, that is omega MS, that is 1 by JMS plus B, we have taken common here, and then KT IAS minus TLS. So now we have those expressions in transfer function form. So then we can easily draw that block diagram. So we can see it here. So this one, if you apply that voltage VAS here, then you have one feedback path that would be that KB omega M. So then if you just divide it by one rational transfer function, that is 1 by RA plus LAS, then you have IAS. So now you can see here, this term we will be getting if you multiply with that KT. So now you have another summer here, plus, then you need to put one external signal, that is TL here, which is acting as disturbance. Then if you divide this one by 1 by JMS plus B, then the output that you will get, that is speed. And here you can see that this is KB into omega M. So basically here in the feedback, you have KB, and this is that feedback path. So this is the block diagram of a DC motor, and sometimes it is asked that the DC motor uses inherent feedback. So this is actually that inherent feedback, what is used by the DC machine. So this is that inherent feedback. So without that feedback, the DC motor cannot work actually, and this is that feedback is established through the back EMF. You can see here, this is that back EMF, that EB, and you can see here that AB equal to KB into omega M, and here you can see that KB into omega M, so that is nothing but that back EMF. So this feedback is established in DC machine through the back EMF. So now this is actually that last physical example we are going to discuss, that is that CART inverted pendulum system, and which is a very interesting as well as very useful physical systems, and it has huge applications, and those again will be performing experiment in control systems lab, so they will be performing that experiment. So this is that example, this is the last example, I am just going to discuss, that is that inverted pendulum. Inverted pendulum. Mounted on a motor driven cart. So here I am just drawing that schematic diagram. So schematic diagram is here. So suppose you have that cart and one pendulum is fixed like this, and this is actually that inverted position, upright position, and if we say that this is angle theta and the total say distance is equal to say this length is suppose 2L, so this one is L and this length is L, and suppose the mass of that cart is capital M and this is that center of gravity, so the mass of that rod is M, so one force will be acting here, that is mg, and here you can see that this length, this one would be L cos theta, this length, and here you can see that this length would be the distance from this one to that point, so that is actually L sin theta. So this distance is, if this is L, so this that would be L sin theta, this distance, that is L sin theta. And from here, easily you can derive that dynamical equation. So suppose this is Y and here some input is applied, that is that U. And suppose this distance is x, so this distance is x. So now we can just represent those terminologies here, that is that m, that is mass of the pendulum rod, and capital M is the mass of the cart on which that pendulum is fixed, and the length of the pendulum rod equal to 2L. So now if you see the coordinate, so here if you say that this coordinate is xz yz, so suppose this coordinate is xz and yz, so here you can see that xz equal to, so this distance x plus this height, sorry, so this distance plus this length of this point, so x plus that is L sin theta. And what is YG? So YG equal to, so L cos theta. We assume that this height is negligible, this height. So negligible. So this height is negligible. So then that y is equal to cos theta, and if I is the moment of inertia of the rod about its center of gravity, so then we have that equation I theta double dot. Here you can see that this is that theta. This theta is very small. So this theta with equal to VL sine theta minus HL cos theta. So now if you just draw that free body diagram here, so this is that vertical force and this is that horizontal force, and here you have that pendulum. You have that pendulum here. This is that pendulum rod, and this angle is theta. This angle is theta. So, and this length is that L cos theta, and this one is L sine theta. So, here that V is that vertical force, H is that horizontal force. So then we have this equation. And along horizontal direction, along horizontal direction, what you have? You have, this is actually that equation for that rod, that is L sine theta, and this is that horizontal force, and along vertical direction. Along vertical direction, we have another equation, that is the displacement is L cos theta. So that is V minus mg, because here you can see that is mg is acting along the direction and V is along the direction. So here you can put actually, so here this is that V, and along this direction you have that H. So then you have two equations, and then we can see what happens in case of that cart, because this is all about this pendulum. Now we are writing the equation for that cart. So for cart, it is the horizontal motion of the cart is described by, so that is simple, that is d2x by dt2. And here U is that applied force and H is that horizontal force. These are the all equations, and you can see here that this is nonlinear equation as that sine, cosine, so those are involved. And here there are four states. So basically X, X dot, theta and theta dot, these are the four states. So if theta, so let theta be small. So it is very small. So then sine theta equal to theta and cos theta equal to 1. So if we assume that one, if whenever theta is very small, so then we can simplify those equations. So 1, 2, 3 and 4. So we can simplify those equations and we get that I theta double dot equal to VL theta minus HL. And another one will be simplified as equal to H, then V equal to mg, and mx double dot equal to U minus H. So whenever we take theta is small, so we can simplify that sine theta equal to theta and cos theta equal to 1, then we have this set of simplified equations. So hence, we obtained just from these four equations, if we replace that x double dot and theta double dot, so then we get that m x double dot plus small x double dot m l theta double dot equal to u. And we have another equation, that is, so here that I double dot equal to, if we take that one on the right hand side, then we have ML x double dot plus L theta double dot. So the first one will get this one, and just by simplification we'll get another dynamical equation, that is I plus M L square theta double dot plus M L x double dot equal to mg L theta. So these are the differential equations that you would have, and this is actually that model of one inverted Karp pendulum system, and here just let us see what we have done. So here in this particular part, so we have started with that linearization, and then we have modeled that attractive type magnetic levitation system, and we got that linearized model at equilibrium point. Then we have taken one simple RLC circuit, and from there we get this state space model as well as signal flow graph, and from there we got the transfer function using Mason-Ghent's formula. Then we have drawn that analogy between that mechanical systems and electrical system, and then we have modeled that DC motor, and the last one what we have done, that is inverted pendulum mounted on a motor driven cart. So it is inverted cart pendulum systems, and so this is some physical systems that we can model using the techniques that you have learned in this course. Thank you.